So what you missed, if you couldn't hear me, was my meaningless open sentence in which I just read the slide to you. So how did I come to this project about CFC and transfer pricing? I suppose in two ways. First off, I've been spending a lot of time recently in my research looking at intangibles under the transfer pricing rules and focusing especially on the recent OECD work with respect to intangibles. And in trying to learn a lot about transfer pricing, I encounter a lot of statements in the literature about the relationship between transfer pricing and CFC. That CFC rules are backstops to transfer pricing, that transfer pricing can shore up weak CFC rules. I've often said these things myself in my class. I've sometimes asked about it on exams. But when I thought about it a little more deeply, I realized there's actually little critical said about this in the literature about why we would do this, when it's a good idea. Is it universally a good idea to use these regimes to prop up one another? Is the relationship symmetrical, such that the CFC can help us with transfer pricing and transfer pricing can help us with CFC in the same way or not? So I began to quest for a normative frame to help with these issues about how the regime should relate to each other. The other thing that motivates the project is I've spent the last year at a tax research institute in Europe talking a lot to European tax lawyers about their views of transfer pricing and CFC legislation. And I came to realize that the American view is somewhat of an exceptional one. That is, we have a view that's very much grounded in viewing the transfer pricing problem as grounded in the haven problem. Whereas many European tax lawyers, at least in the first cut, will view CFC as about curing the haven problem and will view transfer pricing more as a treaty issue about allocating profits among the members of the European Union, for example. So that's the narrow motivation. More broadly, as I began thinking about this and what in the world to write about when you have this open tableau of 100 years of the income tax, I started thinking about more generally how statutes evolve over time and how we see phenomenon arise where provisions are getting at similar problems and yet at the same time discrete problems, so that one provision can be used to battle something else that it wasn't originally designed for. And so in the paper, I describe two sorts of phenomena here. One is what I call statutory parsimony, where you have these two provisions and you say, well, maybe I can just use one provision to knock out both problems. And I want to think about when is that a good or bad thing with respect to CFC and transfer pricing. And then another phenomenon we sometimes see as statutes evolve over time is that of redundancy. So if you're worried one provision isn't solving the problem, well, let's throw another weapon at the problem, and maybe that's a good thing as well. The interaction between CFC and transfer pricing, I think, manifests each of these. So to refer to examples I'll come to at the end of the talk, I think the foreign-based company sales income rules, which I'll explain a little bit when I get to it for the non-specialists in the room, are essentially a case of statutory redundancy. That is, you could solve the problem with a pricing adjustment, and we also can solve it with a CFC inclusion to the extent it applies. Conversely, the commensurate with income rules under Section 367 strike me as they have evolved as a case of parsimony. That is, this is something that originally arose out of concerns that are tied to subpart F, and then if you look at what happened as a regulatory matter under this provision, and the regs just refer you to 482. So we're going to use 482 regs to deal with this problem, one solution for two problems. So I wonder if that's a good thing. And then finally, we sometimes see sharp rejections of tying these two regimes together. So interestingly, at our Tillinghast lecture just a few weeks ago, Mike Schlaer was in the audience, and during the question and answer, he said, well, you know, I thought the whole thing was about transfer of intangibles to havens. And our speaker, Robert Cousin, said, no, that's a CFC problem. I'm interested in transfer pricing. And so he meant to draw a very sharp distinction between these two regimes. So what I'd like to try to get at in these comments and in the paper more generally is something in the way of a normative framework about telling us how we can relate these two parts of the statute to each other. Broadly, I'm going to try to make two claims. So one is a historical claim that the way the statutes evolved, that is to say that the transfer pricing and CFC regimes evolved over time, sort of contingently affected how we view the relationship between the two now. And that is to say, I think we view them as more closely related than perhaps we ought to. The second claim is to strip away the contingent features of the statutory evolution and just go back to simple first principles and say, what are the core functions of these two types of rules, what I call milking versus parking rules at a general level? So I'll divide my comments then into three parts. The first part will talk about this history a little bit. Then second, I'll generate a few comments about what I think of as the core functions of these rules. And then finally, I'll turn the framework to some actual applications to see if there's any payoff. Let me say that I only have one slide, so I am an inexpert at PowerPoint, but I am not so inexpert that I'm forgetting for the whole talk to flip the slide. So don't, that's it for, yeah, okay. Dan will, there it is. Okay, so history. First, let me say or offer a caveat about history. I'm not a historian, and this is a bit embarrassing because we have some of the most prominent tax historians in the audience today. So what I offer here is not any sort of full-fledged historical analysis of these provisions. What I want to do instead is just highlight two ways in which the statute evolved that I think may have affected the way in which we've come to think of without problematic questioning CFC as a backstop to the transfer pricing rules. So the first point of history Deborah mentioned. Did it? Well, we don't need that for now. Did they both turn off? That's all right. We don't need that.
Because you're one slide.
Yeah. This is why I don't use PowerPoint. It's okay. We'll get to it. Okay, so let's talk about history. So the first point about history is a point that Deborah mentioned in her opening comments, which is that the transfer pricing rules have a much longer lineage, going all the way back really to 1917, whereas the full-fledged CFC rules only come about in 1962. But what's interesting is, although the transfer pricing rules were around for a long time before the CFC rules, there was a bit of a leapfrog in 1962. So the transfer pricing rules, if you kind of sketch the history, we have the arm's length standard as early, articulated as early as the 30s. But then it's not until the mid-60s that courts really embrace it as a mandatory principle. And it's not until 1968 that we get any meaningful regulatory guidance about how to interpret the arm's length standard. In the meantime, we get 1962, and subpart F comes in to the code. And if you look at the legislative history, it's replete with these statements that say, oh, transfer pricing is this huge problem. Why we're doing CFC is to shore this up. And so I think the import of this is just to note that that may well have been affected by the complete regulatory vacuum regarding transfer pricing that existed at the time the CFC rules were first enacted. And I don't mean to make some claim that the 68 regs or any regs thereafter made transfer pricing easy or straightforward, but it is the case that in the early 60s and before, courts were struggling with issues that we would never talk about now because they have such ready resolution under the regulations. So the interesting historical counterfactual, I think, is to ask, if the transfer pricing regs had been promulgated in 1958, and then the CFC rules come along in 1962, would we have taken a different view about how the CFC rules are related to the basic transfer pricing problem? I suggest that that's at least a possibility. The second historical point I'd mention goes to the evolution of subpart F from initial proposal to final enactment. So as many of you know, when subpart F was initially put on the table as a much more, meant to be a much more expansive provision. So it would have included all of profits of CFCs on a current basis. We have none of this line drawing, trying to divide good categories from bad categories. The ultimate statute, of course, that we have today represents, as we're familiar with, basic compromise between what we want to do in terms of base preservation and without suggesting, as commentators already pointed out earlier this morning, versus competition. That's a problematic word, and maybe we could talk more about what we mean by competition, but I think that's the basic dynamic. We draw a line between active versus passive, and we're making a basic cut at balancing base erosion principles versus competition of U.S. multinationals. So again, I think much as with the relative timing of the two provisions, the import of this is that I think it affects our initial, or historically, the initial conception of what role subpart F was playing. So under the initial proposal, subpart F would have flattened transfer pricing problems out of existence, at least to the extent that they were happening with CFCs, because whenever you abusively price something under the initial subpart F proposal, it would just come right back into the base. So we would have had no need for the transfer pricing rules. And under that conception, it makes perfect sense to me that you would have viewed CFC as fixing the transfer pricing problem. But of course, as it was ultimately enacted, it was doing something very different. It was making this compromise, taking a compromise position between base and the competition issues. Okay, so that's the points about history. Let me now say a few words about what I think is going on at the core with respect to what I'm gonna call milking versus parking, pricing abuses versus leaving parking profits offshore. This is a bit of a scholarly or conceptual high wire act, because what I really want to do here is state idealized versions of milking and parking regimes, idealized versions of anti-pricing abuses and anti-keeping profits offshore regimes. I want to ground that roughly in the contours of the U.S. system, so a worldwide system that uses a foreign tax credit and separate entity accounting for transfer pricing. But what I don't mean to do is to say that whenever we have parking, that's CFC, go look at section 951 in the code, and whenever we have milking, that's 482. The whole point is these sections have gotten clouded. We've used one to do one problem and the other to do the other problem, and I want to go back and think about the core, the ideal, and then we can tease it apart and ask, what remedy should we be using for which problem? So to get at the core, and what I'm going to say here is this is it's going to sound mundane and maybe as if it doesn't need saying, except for the fact that then when we turn to the statute, we'll see that we've, become confused in places about what the core issues are. So I divide the core issue in the idealized regime into two aspects. One is what's going on with respect to international base allocation, and what is the sort of reference transaction the rule is looking at. And the second is what is the remedy? What tool do we use to get there? So let's take what I'm going to call core parking first. So what is this idea of parking about? Well, we can start with a reference transaction, which is it's a U.S. parent company and a foreign branch. And obviously, in that case, everything gets included. Currently, if you create a subsidiary instead and operate the branch through a subsidiary, this at least opens the possibility for deferral, for what I call parking. And the government, of course, can cut back on that by forcing a current inclusion. What criteria would we use to do this? Well, this is what I mentioned a second ago. We would look at base erosion versus competition of the US parent company with foreign companies. Crucially, what this regime does, I think, is it contributes importantly to the rules substantively about the international allocation of the tax base. So my co-panelist, David Lenter, will talk later. He refers to it as a jurisdictional rule. I like that language as well. And I think the CFC rules are jurisdictional in that sense. The transfer pricing rules, or what I should stick with my paradigm, what I should call milking rules at the core, are not about that. They are not about figuring out international base allocation in the first instance. Here, the relevant reference transaction is not US parent and foreign branch. It's US taxpayer and unrelated third party. The potential advantage that a taxpayer can achieve through milking or abusive pricing is, of course, to move profits out of the base. When the government articulates a rule that reverses the abusive pricing and shifts the profit back to another taxpayer, that in itself we shouldn't think of as a substantive base allocation rule. That is to say, the pricing rules themselves are not premised on balancing competition versus base erosion. Those rules come from somewhere else. They come from the substantive sourcing rule. So again, I'll refer to my co-panelist's paper because I think we exactly agree on this. So he says we have two types of jurisdictional rules in the US system. We have the CFC foreign tax credit rules and then the sourcing rules. And I completely agree on this, that when we're talking about milking, the allocation question across jurisdictions is done through the source rules. Let me just drop a quick footnote here, which is that's US domestic law. Treaty law looks very different. So in treaty law, the arm's length principle and the transfer pricing inquiry is about international base allocation because it's essentially constraining what states can do in writing their source rules. But in the domestic context, what the milking phenomenon is doing is it's constraining taxpayers and how they can set prices. It's not constraining states. So now I've set out these two core things, a core problem, parking, leaving profits offshore, a core problem of milking. Hopefully the slide will appear within the next 30 seconds. If not, I'll use hand gestures. Note that the remedies in the core are perfectly tailored to the problem. So if the problem in the core of parking is retaining profits offshore and achieving a result that's different from that of the branch, then the remedy is current inclusion or some type of finance charge that equates the result to the branch activity. If instead you are in the regime of milking, then again, the remedy, a price adjustment or a profit adjustment, is exactly perfectly tailored to replicating the case where you have unrelated third parties. Now the kind of the payoff, the bottom line, and this may appear just on cue. One can clearly use a milking remedy, a price adjustment, to combat a parking problem. And conversely, one can use parking problem, current inclusion, to reflect abusive pricing. That is the direction, directionally, it goes in the right place. But the magnitude will be off. What's that?
This is where we need it.
This is where I need my slide. Let me describe the slide. It's one slide, and it's also very simple. So the slide, which will no doubt appear any second, it says this. I have a vertical line, right, that divides what I call US current income and foreign deferred. That's a basic base allocation point that is determined by what I think of as the parking rules or the CFC rules. Once you draw that line, okay, so you've told taxpayers we've basically drafted some categories of income. And if your income is in this category, you can park it and not pay current tax. If it's in the other category, you pay current tax. So sharp line, right, between US current, foreign deferred. Once you have this sharp line between the US current and foreign deferred, you've obviously created, great, okay. There's my sharp line.
Looks like this unit's failing, so we'll have to
talk quickly.
Just go ahead with it.
Do it quickly. All right, so this vertical line is my basic split that's generated by the parking rules between US current and foreign deferred. Once you have that dichotomy, splitting the base from something that's taxed currently to something that will not be taxed currently, we obviously create large incentives for abusive pricing to get profits on this side of the line, the tax-preferred side of the line, as compared to that. Now, the point I was getting is, of course, we can reverse these effects using either rule. So let's take each case. Suppose that we have written what we might think of as suboptimal CFC rules. That is to say, maybe they're too generous. They're giving too much foreign deferral, too much parking. Well, obviously, we can go the right direction, combat that in a directional sense by having pricing adjustments. That is to switch profits that move things back into the US base. Similarly, if we've botched the transfer pricing rules, so taxpayers can still milk, can still abusively price so that they're getting a lot of stuff offshore, We can combat that by moving this line to the right, by changing the categories of income that benefit from deferral or parking in the first instance. So to return to my big categories of redundancy and parsimony, I want to suggest these two principles. So I started out saying I want to kind of generate some sort of normative frame about how these things relate to each other. Actually, I'll give you 3 points. One is, of course, you can use them, and they go in the right direction, but the magnitude is likely to be wrong, because the basic normative criterion, abusive pricing versus setting the base versus competition issue, are completely different. That's point one. Point two is that there is an exception. That is, there is one case where I think the CFC rules, the parking rules, can be used to good effect to counter pricing abuses, and it is exactly this case. It's where you can write a general rule, the level of the category of income, that captures a base that is likely only to arise because of pricing abuse. So if you can write a general rule that says this category of income is income, it arises only because of pricing abuse, then it's much better to write a general rule than have to mess around with case-by-case transfer pricing adjustments. That is to say, sometimes parking CFC remedies will be good ones to counteract transfer pricing problems. Third point, I think there's an asymmetry. It's almost never gonna run in the other direction. It's almost always gonna be a bad idea to try to fix suboptimal, lousy CFC rules through transfer pricing. We do it, but I think it's a really bad idea. Where am I on time, given
pretty
the delay?
Pretty wrap up.
Okay, let me leave with one. The paper goes through four applications. Let me do one to kind of show you what the payoff is of this conceptual structure. This will hook up good because I think David talks about this too. So let me mention just the excess returns proposal that's been articulated by the President Obama's administration a couple of times. So the basic idea here is under a subpart F is a proposal that so-called excess returns from intangible transfers would come into income currently. So it's an expansion of subpart F to capture this. The excess returns are defined as basically a cost plus over allocated costs, and then an excess amount of that comes into income currently. The way I would want to approach that problem is to ask, is it a milking problem or is it a parking problem? Not, you know, just because we're drafting it in the 951 at sec part of the code, it's therefore CFC and therefore parking. That doesn't answer the interesting question to me. The interesting question could be framed as this. It could be one or both, but they have different meanings. Then the question is, where does the excess return come from? So to hook up with stuff that my colleagues Noel and Mitch were talking about, the excess return could be a supernormal profit. And if that's the case, then we have a parking problem. That is to say, we have a supernormal profit being held offshore, and that looks like a really good thing, a good base to tax. It's a parking problem, and we should think about it through a parking lens. Alternatively, it could be that the reason we have an excess profit has nothing to do with supernormal return, but we're only showing an excess profit because there was abusive pricing or milking in the first instance. And then it's a milking problem, and then that would generate a different sort of solution. So the bottom line I want to leave you with is just that we think a little more carefully rather than having blinders about what section of the code we're in, is what sort of problem are we trying to solve? And when is it a good idea to use which remedy to solve that problem? And that the worst thing we can do is write really lousy CFC rules, for example, by giving away too much in the active royalties exception, and then think we can pick up the pieces by having more robust transfer pricing for intangibles.
Thank you, Dan. Warning, I had a class last night and a class this morning, so my voice may be a little raspy. I'll try to fight through that. Usually when you are invited to speak at a conference like this, whether it's partnership tax or corporate tax or international tax, the audience is primarily people who are mired in the details. They work on it on a daily basis, and they're there to brush up or to hear views on emerging issues. I sense that is not true of much of the audience today, so I'm going to keep my topic at a level of generality that I think recognizes that, as much as the subject matter lets me. When you hear the words international tax today, in the public press, in the presidential campaigns, immediately you zero in, it seems to me, on one problem, and that is the perceived failures of the U.S. tax system to tax profits earned by foreign subsidiaries of U.S. corporations. International tax is a lot more than that, but that seems to be the only thing that anybody thinks of. And there are three basic elements to the system we have in place to tax foreign subsidiaries. The two things that Mitchell and David have and will talk about, transfer pricing and our foreign-based company sales rules. The third element is the foreign tax credit system. That's my subject. It's much less abstract, and it's much less, at this point in time, historical in nature. Now, as I think most of you know, you get a credit, and I'm going to focus the picture on U.S. multinational with offshore subsidiaries. Those companies get a credit for taxes that they pay to foreign governments or that their subsidiaries pay, the latter tax being known in the trade as the indirect credit. That's where the bulk of the foreign tax credits lie, indirect credits for taxes paid by the subsidiaries of our U.S.-based multinationals. If we were celebrating the 60th anniversary instead of the 100th anniversary of the tax system, it would be a very different situation. Many of the most troubling aspects of the foreign tax credit system would not yet have come into being, and many of the rules that have been written in the last 30, 35 years obviously wouldn't be in place. If you fast forward to today, I think you have to conclude that unlike the condition of the things that Mitchell and David are talking about, the condition of the foreign tax credit rules are pretty good. There's really not that much left to do to improve them. Technical refinements, but basically a lot has happened to clean up some of the messes that have occurred over the last few years. At the same time, the ascendancy of the value of intellectual assets owned by U.S. multinationals and companies from other countries as well, and laxity, I would say, on the part of our government to make the subpart F rules react the way they should have to developments, and I'm speaking now primarily to the freedom we have to choose the entity classification of our choice, those have created problems that have become worse as the foreign tax credit problems have basically gone into repose. So I'm going to talk, again, at a very general level, as much as the subject lets me, about the three main lines of authority that have arisen under the foreign tax credit. That is, what kinds of taxes are creditable, what limitations that have been placed on them, and finally, what I think is the most interesting of the three subjects and the most recent, and that is how to deal with what is perceived in some quarters as foreign tax credit abuse. So, Dan, you'll give me a hint every now and then about the time.
Yeah, so far, only about 3 minutes.
Is 20 minutes up already? No. go back to, first we'll talk about what taxes are creditable. We didn't have a foreign tax credit until 1918, so it's 5 years younger than the income tax system we're talking about today. In 1918, Congress decided that rising tax rates necessitated by the costs of World War I created greater threats of double taxation, so it was time to turn what previously was a deduction for foreign taxes into a credit. So just think about that. You pay a dollar of tax to the United Kingdom. Until 1918, it saved you 35 cents in U.S. tax. Starting in 1918, it saved you a dollar. What was thought at the time to be a profound change. We take it for granted now, but it was a profound change. And because of its profundity, from the beginning, Congress has been very jealous in the way it defines creditable taxes. Couple of points just to keep in mind. If you pay a levy to a foreign government, it's not necessarily a tax. And over the evolving 50, 60 years of history with the foreign tax credit, a few issues have arisen just on the question of whether what you pay to a foreign country is a tax. Is it instead a disguised royalty that oil companies might pay for the privilege of exploring for and producing oil? Is it a subsidized payment, one that is rebated back to the taxpayer or to a counterparty with which the taxpayer has done the business, which give rise to the tax. In either of those cases, the tax doesn't really stick with the foreign country, and we're not willing to give a dollar-for-dollar offset for those kinds of exactions by a foreign country. Equally important is the requirement that the tax had to be compulsory. You couldn't lay down at the feet of a foreign revenue agency and say, yes, I owe that, let me write you a check, because I'll be reimbursed by the United States Treasury. So historically, you had to do your reasonable best to minimize foreign taxes over time. The rules didn't tell you that you had to change your way of doing business, but they did tell you that whatever form of business you engage in, you have to do your best to minimize foreign taxes. Those are the issues that bear on whether something's a tax. Now, in 1918, we were thinking about double tax relief for income taxes. That's what we imposed, and that was the only kind of tax that we were going to grant a credit for. So historically, and to this day, only income taxes enjoy, with minor exceptions, a foreign tax credit. Why did we do that? I think part of it was simply an unthinking thing. We employ income taxes, we'll credit income taxes that you impose. If you want to impose a value-added tax, a wealth tax, et cetera, you don't get any credit for that. I think subsumed within that judgment was the idea that income taxes were the most difficult to pass on to someone else economically through pricing of transactions. So a little more assurance that the credit we're giving you is for a tax that you pay and that you have not passed on to somebody else. Now, before I leave the subject, I want to mention a very important rule, obscure to people outside the field, but important to those within. Our regulations give you a credit if you're the so-called technical taxpayer. That is, you're the person who, under foreign law, is obligated to pay the tax. That's all it takes. If, in fact, you pass the burden of the tax economically on to someone else, it doesn't spoil your entitlement to a credit. I'll come back to that in a little bit when we start talking about what I described as potentially abusive uses of the foreign tax credit. All of these ideas were synthesized into regulations that were issued in the early 1980s, and boiled down, those regulations ask, is the payment you've made to the foreign country, by its predominant overall character, close to, if not identical to, a U.S. income tax? Does it have a realization requirement? Does it measure the base beginning with gross receipts? And does it allow for deduction of significant costs? If the answers to all those three questions are yes, or close to yes, you win the case. Since 1983, when the regulations were written, there have been maybe four or five important cases in the area. So you'd have to say that the law is well settled. Two footnotes. One is that countries often like to devise their own taxes and not be forced by our credibility rules to draw an income tax. Treaties sometimes help them in that regard by rescuing creditability for taxes that would not qualify as a pure income tax in the statutory sense. The other footnote is that although I said the law has gotten quiescent in the area, as it so happens, 1 week from today, the Supreme Court will decide whether to grant certiorari in a foreign tax credit case that arose a couple of years ago involving a windfall profits tax imposed in the late 1990s by the United Kingdom. The tax court ruled that these were creditable taxes a couple of years ago. The government took the case up on appeal to the Third and Fifth Circuit. The Third Circuit reversed the tax court. The Fifth Circuit affirmed. And as I said, the case is going to be under review by the court next Friday. Just a minute on this tax. It gives you a sense of how far off the beaten path questions of creditable taxes can become. The Thatcher government wanted to privatize what were previously regulated utility companies in the United Kingdom. So they sold shares to private investors at a particular price. It turned out in retrospect that the price may have been a bit too low. And when the Labour Party took over, they wanted to tax what they thought were the excess profits of these companies. But they couldn't do so in a straightforward way. for a combination of political and legal reasons. So they crafted a very unusual looking tax. It was a tax based at a 23% rate on 9 times average earnings over a 4-year period in excess of the price at which the company was sold to private investors. Now, if you see 9 times profits, you start thinking, well, that's a tax on value. But if you do a little algebra and you restate the tax, you discover that just by changing the rate from the nominal rate to an effective rate, it turns out to be a very straightforward looking, as I saw it, tax on excess profits, and that's what persuaded the tax court. But we have 2 diametrically opposing views on that from the Court of Appeals. So the Supreme Court might inject itself in this issue again, really for the first time in decades, on the contours of creditable taxes. Next subject, and this one I'm going to skip over very quickly because it's truly inside baseball. It's very technical, and that is the limitation on foreign tax credits. It was enacted in 1921, 3 years after Congress decided to grant a credit. Prior to that time, if you paid taxes to a particular country in excess of the U.S. rate, they were essentially refundable credits. You could use the excess taxes, the excess of the foreign rate over the U.S. rate, essentially to recover taxes that you would have paid the United States Treasury on your United States source income. It was quickly discovered that wasn't acceptable, so we had a limitation beginning in 1921, and it was there in the first and most basic instance to protect the U.S. tax base. It then became much more technical, and the question arose, should we protect the right of the United States to impose a residual tax on earnings in countries where the tax rate was less than the rate in the United States? So we had an oscillating set of rules over many decades. Should we have one foreign tax credit limitation, the so-called overall? Should we do it on a country-by-country basis? Should we do it on an activity-by-activity basis? We've tried everything at one point or another. Today we have a so-called basket system. But just to give you a very elementary illustration of the stakes, the United States has a 35% rate today, as I'm sure you know, on corporations. That is, at last count, either the highest rate in the world or the second highest rate. So the idea that you would be paying a rate in excess of that in a foreign country may seem a bit obscure. It can happen because of differences in accounting rules, but let's just play along and assume that you have 2 subsidiaries. One pays tax to a foreign country at a 45% rate, one pays tax to a foreign country at a 25% rate. So these are far off the actual rates, but we'll just posit one's Germany, one's Ireland. If you do one foreign tax credit limitation, you can average the high German taxes against the low Irish taxes. If you do separate calculations, you cannot, and therefore you preserve the ability of the United States to collect a residual tax on the income earned in Ireland. From there, things got very technical, and I'm going to dance over this very quickly, because 2 types of issues, I think, have absorbed Congress and Treasury over the years as they've refined the foreign tax credit limitation. One is the scope issue that I just described. Overall, per country, baskets, et cetera. The other one is much more technical, and it has to do with purely the mathematical workings of the limitation. Because it's an annual calculation, and because it focuses just on the place where you earn income, it can screw things up if you have losses in 1 year and profits in another. And depending on whether they're foreign losses or domestic losses, you can have a situation where income earned in the United States escapes tax permanently anywhere, or income earned abroad is taxed twice. Congress was aware of those things and fixed them in 1976 and again in 2004. They dealt with a similar problem dealing with capital gains, taking out of the limitation fraction the portion of capital gains that were effectively tax exempt by virtue of the preferential rate enjoyed by individual taxpayers. These, I think, enough has been said on. So what I want to turn to now, one last point, that just for information, many people may not know this. The oil companies take quite a beating for a variety of reasons, but one lament they have is grounded in reality. They are subject to a special type of limitation under a particular provision of the Internal Revenue Code that takes away any credit they might have for taxes paid to foreign countries in excess of the U.S. rate. That is shaved off the top, and you're often talking about rates in the neighborhood of 70% to 80% when you calculate national and subnational taxes. That is taken off the top before the oil company can then go through the normal exercise of figuring out its foreign tax credit limitation. This is an outgrowth of the fact that there has always been a suspicion that many of the taxes paid by oil companies are not really taxes at all. They're disguised royalties. Whether that's accurate or not in a given case is debatable, but they have been and continue to be subject to the special limitation that taxpayers in other industries don't have to face. 5 minutes. Okay, last subject. This is the one I think that's most interesting. I have a very scary slide that I want to put on the board. Very unlike the abstract inquiries we've been hearing about today, this is nuts and bolts, but a quick summary of the backdrop. In 1986, we dropped our corporate rate from 46 to 35%. We expected that that would eventuate in our companies paying excess credits, high foreign taxes to other companies, because our rate was low and theirs would continue to be high. What eventuated was that they dropped their rates following our invitation, and also tax advisors of U.S. multinationals did a very good job of planning for foreign tax reduction. So between reductions in nominal rates and strategies to reduce effective rates, what we found was a situation where many taxpayers were in so-called excess limitation posture. They had in their hands a coupon, effectively, that they could turn into the U.S. Treasury to be reimbursed for foreign taxes that they paid. Now, if you think about it, paying more foreign taxes just to be reimbursed by the United States is not a sensible strategy, unless you can doctor the foreign taxes. And what happened over roughly a 20-year period ending today or in the recent past is essentially two strategies were devised in order to doctor foreign taxes. One was to inflate the effective rate through a variety of techniques that are usually described by people in the business as so-called splitter transactions, where by virtue of different ways in which foreign tax systems and the United States system works, you can separate the income on which a tax has been imposed from the tax itself. If you think about that, that means you can put a tax on a U.S. tax return that has an effective foreign tax rate of approaching 100%. So here's your coupon, your excess limitation. Here's your tax that has been doctored up to look higher than it really is, and this was perceived to be a serious problem. Treasury wrote regulations to deal with it. They sat on the shelf. Congress intervened a couple of years ago, and we now have a section of the code that international tax lawyers are very familiar with, Section 909, that deals with splitter strategies. Now, what I think is the more interesting development is a different type of strategy. If you had excess limitation and you could design a transaction that resulted in the payment of foreign taxes in a legal and technical sense, but which were economically borne by the other party you were engaging in business with, then you could really make the U.S. tax system your personal cost reduction center. Hence the invention of the so-called foreign tax credit generator. I just have a few more minutes, so I'm going to cut right to the chase. And please don't run to the door when you see this slide. It's a picture of an actual transaction. These deals are, pardon me? Yeah, no, I've got one right here. These deals are, if this is not oversimplifying it too much, loans that are structured in a way to turn some of the borrower's cost, which would otherwise be a simple interest deduction, into a foreign tax credit, or to turn the lender's return, which would otherwise simply be interest income, into income that carries a foreign tax credit. And if you study the economics, they can take a transaction that is marginal or perhaps negative before you account for the foreign tax credit and make it positive. That's where you make money. And it's easily demonstrated in many of these transactions that if it originates in the United States, it all comes at the expense of the United States Treasury. Now, the picture on the board is an actual transaction that originated in Canada. Taxpayers there do the same thing. The companies on the left, where you see the picture F Bank, that's a Canadian bank lending money to the companies on the right, which is a U.S. bank. If it was a simple loan, the U.S. bank would get an interest deduction, the Canadian lender would have income taxable in Canada, and that would be the end of it. But if you structure the loan proceeds to pass through the entity on the board is the one called USRH. That is an entity that is a corporation for U.S. purposes, but it's a partnership for Canadian tax purposes. You can place the Canadian taxpayer, that's the company abbreviated APPT. This was a litigated case in Canada. By the way, the taxpayer won. But the appellant was treated under Canadian tax law as the partner in this partnership, USRH. If you were to follow the bouncing ball throughout this transaction, you would see that the net effect on the U.S. tax system is what you would expect in a loan. The net effect is a deduction. But if you look at the pieces separately, you will see a tax liability paid by USRH. This is the liability that the appellant claimed as a credit against its Canadian tax. It was shown at the trial that the transaction was close to negative, if not negative, before accounting for the credit, but positive only by reason of the credit. In Canada, it worked. Today, we have regulations that address this, and we have six cases or so pending in court in which the government has gone after, our government, has gone after cases that predate the regulations. So it will be interesting to see how these evolve. I happen to think they're going to have a lot to say about the contours of the economic substance doctrine. So I think I'm just about out of time, right? Yeah.
So as a preliminary matter, I wanted to say thank you, Dan, and thank you, Deborah, for inviting me. I like my day job, but it is spirit-lifting to get out of the funny little town of Washington, D.C. occasionally and participate in a gathering like this. As a government drone, I'm also obligated to say at the outset that my comments here are my own and don't represent the views of any member of Congress or the Joint Committee on Taxation. So I'll start my presentation with the example that I start my paper with. We'll talk about the taxation of a hypothetical computer software company headquartered in the Pacific Northwest. Just to be clear, this is a highly stylized example based on a couple public accounts. So we'll start with a simple case. Let's say the company's software engineers sit in the United States and develop a patented computer operating system, and the software company sells the operating system to customers in the United States. In that simple case, it seems non-controversial that the United States should claim primary taxing rights over all the company's patent-related income from its software sales. Now I'll make things a little more complicated. Let's say the company sells its operating system both in the United States and abroad. Should the United States still have the primary right to tax all the company's patent-related sales income? Now, consider the more realistic scenario in which the company does more abroad than simply sell to foreign customers. The company has subsidiaries in Ireland, Puerto Rico, and Singapore. These subsidiaries pay for a portion of the global company's expenditures on research and development activities. Software engineers employed by the three foreign subsidiaries contribute to the development of newer versions of the operating system by, for example, tailoring the operating system to the local markets. The subsidiaries also manufacture physical copies of the operating system. And the Irish, Puerto Rican, and Singaporean subsidiaries sell and distribute the operating system to customers in the respective regions. In this more complicated and also more realistic scenario, the extent to which the United States should assert primary taxing rights over all the company's patent-related income from the sales of its operating system is, to me at least, unclear. My paper is not about how the United States should tax this sort of cross-border intangible income. After all, as a staffer on a nonpartisan committee, I'm paid not to have opinions on big politically charged topics. Instead, my paper is about the competing policies that Congress has over time pursued in enacting special rules related to the taxation of cross-border income from intangible property. And it is also about the competing policy goals underlying recent legislative proposals and possible new departures suggested by these new proposals. Before getting into this policy discussion, I'd like to say a few words about what we mean when we talk about intangible property income and about why the taxation of cross-border intangible income matters. On the definitional question, there are two ways of thinking about the meaning of income from intangible property, such as patents, copyrights, trademarks, and trade names. One way is conceptual. You can think of the corporate income tax as capturing a corporation's returns on its equity capital. A corporation might invest that equity capital in tangible property, such as a machine or a factory, and if it is doing what it is supposed to be doing, it will earn a rate of return on its invested equity capital. To the extent a company achieves a return not attributable to its investment of equity capital in tangible property, that return you might think of as being income from intangible property. A second way of understanding intangible property income is not by reference to this residual concept, but instead by reference to a definition in the Internal Revenue Code. And I've put up on this screen the broadest definition that we have in the code of intangible property. You'll see that this definition includes items that I've already mentioned and that are familiar to all of you: patents, copyrights, trademarks, trade names. It also includes items that may be less familiar: methods, programs, estimates, technical data, customer lists, for example. And when we move away from this code definition of intangible property to the question of what constitutes income from intangible property, you will see that it is not always so easy to identify this income. It is easy enough to say that when a company licenses the use of a patent and receives a royalty for the license, this royalty is intangible property income. But what if, as one example, Procter & Gamble sells the laundry detergent Tide? How might we determine the extent to which the sales income from Tide detergent represents a return on the brand name Tide? Now, on the question of why the taxation of cross-border intangible income matters, the paper has a lot of data to show the significance of intangible property. I'll just give a few highlights here. So one study has found that from 1998 through 2000, U.S. businesses spent about $1.2 trillion annually on intangible property, about 13% of gross domestic product in those years. And that amount of spending, the authors of the study concluded, was about the same as the amount of spending on tangible property in those years. Perhaps the best reliable measure that we have of the importance to U.S. multinational companies of cross-border intangible property income is the volume of royalties and license fees paid between U.S. multinationals and their foreign affiliates. In 2010, U.S. parent companies received total net royalties and license fees of $57.8 billion from their foreign affiliates. In the same year, these U.S. parent companies had an aggregate return of $409.5 billion attributable to their equity and debt investments in these foreign affiliates, So one way of thinking about this is that for every $7 that the U.S. parent companies generated in a return on their equity and debt investments in foreign affiliates, they received $1 in net royalties and license fees. So having established, I hope, that intangible property income is a big deal empirically, I'll turn to the policy discussion of my paper. The code includes a number of rules related specifically to the taxation of cross-border intangible income. Some of these rules are taxpayer-friendly. These rules, as I describe in some more detail in the paper, cede to other countries the primary right to tax much cross-border intangible income of U.S. multinational companies. So as just one example of the rules that I describe in the paper, if a U.S. multinational grants a foreign affiliate or a foreign unrelated company a license to use its patent in its business outside the United States, and the U.S. parent company receives royalty income for the license, those payments are foreign source income. The foreign source royalty income is subject to U.S. tax, but as I detail in the paper, its foreign source status helps the U.S. multinational in its foreign tax credit planning. U.S. multinationals, it turns out, use excess foreign tax credits from other high-tax business income to offset much of the residual U.S. tax on what turns out to be low-tax foreign source royalty income. Other special code rules for intangible income are taxpayer unfriendly. These rules elevate the substance over form in related party transactions and thereby circumscribe the more general respect for the separateness of related legal entities. These rules are, as I describe in a little more detail in the paper, and as Mitchell has talked about, the commensurate with income requirement for related party transfers under the transfer pricing rules of Section 482, and the similar commensurate with income requirement under Sections 367D for transfers of intangible property by domestic corporations to foreign corporations. In very brief form, the commensurate with income rules may add to a U.S. taxpayer's tax liability by potentially requiring the U.S. taxpayer to take into account over time, as, for example, deemed royalty payments, amounts based on the income that is actually generated by transferred intangible property, even though the deal that was struck at the time may have been arm's length and may have provided for different payment streams. So if you look at the legislative history related to these and other taxpayer-friendly and taxpayer-unfriendly rules for taxing cross-border intangible income, you will see two consistent competing policy themes. On the one hand, Congress has sought to stop the tax-favored outbound migration of intangible property and income. To describe this policy, I will use the shorthand anti-migration. On the other hand, Congress has tried to avoid taxing U.S. multinational companies on their cross-border intangible income in a manner that's more burdensome than the taxation faced by foreign firms of similar income. And to describe this policy, I'll use the shorthand avoidance of relative burdens. If you're familiar with the debates over international tax policy more generally, you'll notice that the tension between these two competing policies is a microcosm of the larger debate over the proper theoretical basis for our general scheme of taxing cross-border income, a debate that has persisted for five decades. The anti-migration policy can be understood in the larger context of the so-called capital export neutrality framework, that the U.S. international tax rules should not create a tax preference for foreign investment over domestic investment. The avoidance of relative burdens policy can be understood in the context of a larger view, the so-called capital import neutrality view, that the proper measure of efficiency is whether a U.S. and a foreign firm operating in a third country are taxed equally on income from that third country. I should note that commentators, including prominently Dan Shaviro, have argued that this decades-old debate over neutralities is unsatisfactory in all sorts of ways. The debate over international tax policy, unsatisfactory though many think it might be, continues unabated. Journalists, commentators, and policymakers are focusing now particularly on intangible income. policymakers have heard competing narratives. On the one hand, they are aware of stories describing the ways in which Apple, Google, various pharmaceutical firms, and other U.S. companies pay very little U.S. tax on their cross-border intangible income. On the other hand, they have heard arguments that the U.S. tax rules disadvantage U.S. multinationals relative to their foreign peers. And relevant here, U.S. policymakers have heard that other foreign countries have adopted preferential rules for taxing patent-related income, so-called patent box regimes. Partly because there has been so much focus on these competing narratives, the Obama administration, the chairman of the House Ways and Means Committee, a Republican member of the Senate Finance Committee, and at least two other members of Congress have put forward legislative proposals related to the taxation of intangible property income. I won't describe these proposals in any detail here. I'll just notice that the proposals include a number of taxpayer-friendly and taxpayer-unfriendly elements. For example, Chairman Camp's international tax reform proposal and Senator Mike Enzi's international tax reform bill include provisions that lower the rate of U.S. tax on certain intangible income from serving foreign markets. On the taxpayer-unfriendly side, Chairman Camp's and Senator Enzi's proposals and the Obama administration proposal that Mitchell has referred to also significantly broaden the U.S. taxation of intangible income that is earned by foreign subsidiaries of U.S. parent companies and is subject to a low rate of foreign income tax. Back on the taxpayer-friendly side are the so-called patent box proposals in the United States now that provide a preferential rate for income attributable to U.S.-developed intellectual property. If you look at the explanatory materials describing the rationales for these recent proposals, you will see the two competing policy themes that have informed the current special code rules for intangible income, the anti-migration and the avoidance of relative burden objectives. For the patent box proposals, you will also see a third theme, the desire to encourage U.S. research and an anxiety that the U.S. is losing what is seen as its leading global position in research and innovation. Like the other two competing policies that I've already described, this desire to encourage U.S. research and anxiety about the U.S.'s global position are not new. The legislative history related to the research credit, for example, which was enacted in 1981, reveals exactly those concerns. So to some extent, we have new proposals and old goals. And to illustrate the continuity of goals over time, I'll put up on the screen a few quotations describing the rationales for the various present law provisions and recent proposals. You'll see for each policy very, very similar statements over time. I said in relation to these new legislative proposals that they represent old goals to some extent because, as I describe in more detail in the paper, the proposals include two departures from the existing structure of cross-border taxation, destination-based rules and formula-based rules. I'm not going to describe those departures here, though I think they are significant. And I should say as well that I think that this part of my paper is possibly the least well-developed, so I'd be curious to hear your thoughts about where these thoughts about destination-based and formula-based rules might lead. But rather than dwelling on those two departures here, I thought it might be appropriate at a conference on the Internal Revenue Code. So I thought it would be appropriate to deal here at a conference which is about the Internal Revenue Code at 100 to ask a couple questions that situate the present and possible future code rules related to cross-border intangible income in a broader context. The first question is about competing policy goals. I have described the competing policy goals as being, on the one hand, preventing the tax-favored migration of intangible property and income abroad, and on the other hand, avoiding taxing U.S. multinationals in a manner that's more burdensome than the taxation faced by foreign firms on similar income. These policy goals are, of course, meaningful only by reference to broader underlying policy objectives. The neutrality principles that have dominated international tax debates are premised on the notion that the U.S. international tax rules should be, in one form or another, welfare maximizing. Policymakers in Washington have more prosaic aims. They might want to encourage investments in the United States, and in particular, the development and ownership of intellectual property in the U.S. In the language of politics, they might want to create jobs. They might want to help U.S. firms compete across borders on the theory that having large, profitable U.S. multinationals has all sorts of benefits for the U.S. economy. On the other hand, policymakers might want to stop the erosion of the corporate tax base, or put more bluntly, they might have particular revenue goals. And here's the difficulty. Policymakers might want to use special tax rules for cross-border intangible income to further some or all of these goals simultaneously. A question is whether policymakers are thereby asking too much of the tax code, whether special rules for cross-border intangible income can further multiple competing policy goals simultaneously is, I think, particularly uncertain, given that we've seen a breakdown of what I take to have been a tacit agreement among big industrialized countries over the years against tax competition and instead in favor of taxation of cross-border income of multinationals at significant rates. As one particularly prominent example of this, the breakdown in this tacit agreement, the United Kingdom has reduced its corporate tax rate to 24% and has plans to reduce it to 22% by 2014, has introduced a territorial system for taxing cross-border income, and has introduced a patent box regime to reduce taxation of UK-registered patent income. So a question is whether the U.S. tax rules simultaneously can encourage both foreign and U.S. investment and protect the revenue base when the U.K. and other countries are competing to reduce tax burdens on multinationals. The second question is about the overall coherence of the U.S. international tax system. The U.S. scheme for taxing cross-border income has, as many of you know, a couple of foundational principles. One is source-based taxation of much cross-border business income. Another is arm's-length transfer pricing. Problems in the taxation of cross-border intangible income are, at bottom, problems about source and transfer pricing. So, to which entity in a multinational group should income be allocated? And similarly, in which country does income arise? But the recent proposals related to the taxation of cross-border intangible income make no changes to the transfer pricing or source of income rules. This reluctance to address transfer pricing or sourcing is understandable because, among other reasons, changes to those rules have direct bilateral and multilateral consequences. For example, a change to the transfer pricing rules that allocates more income to the United States will have the immediate effect of allocating less income to another country, or more likely will lead to disputes between the U.S. and other countries under treaties and otherwise. The reluctance to revise the transfer pricing or sourcing rules is understandable for a related reason. There are ongoing multilateral projects through the OECD on the topics of both transfer pricing and sourcing. An important example, which I do not discuss in my paper, is the OECD's draft of changes to the transfer pricing guidelines for intangibles. And I won't say much about the revision to the transfer pricing guidelines for intangibles here, other than to point out that they are moving away from traditional notions of arm's length. So although it is understandable that recent legislative proposals do not address transfer pricing and sourcing problems directly, a question is the extent to which the U.S. international tax rules generally, already under great stress from attempts to achieve policy goals that are in tension with one another, can remain coherent if new special rules are layered on existing rules and when, as I have described in my paper, those new rules undercut but do not directly alter fundamental principles of the current cross-border scheme for taxing cross-border income. Thank you.
One question and then turn it open. Sure. So, seem to have lost my voice. Mitch, I'll start, I'll go in order. Mitch, my question for you is this. So, you have these two ideas, milking and parking. And I understand that milking has a baseline to it, what you call the reference transaction to a degree. And I think we both agree that it's not doesn't kind of work 100%. And that is the separately owned entity, arm's length, the true arm's length idea. That won't fully solve these problems, but the way I like to think of it is, if it's more efficient to be a multi-net commonly owned than not, there'll sort of be some synergy income of the common ownership, and it's not clear how to allocate that. But at least it kind of says, I agree you have a reference transaction for milking, which is that, gee, if these guys were dealing at arm's length, the price couldn't possibly be less than this or more than that. And the U.S. would care about one of those two sides more than the other, depending whether it's inbound or outbound. But I don't know if I understand what the reference transaction really is for parking, because it's not branch, because we don't tax. Deferral allows active business income of subsidiaries, unlike that of branches, not to be currently taxed. So I don't see what the reference transaction or what the baseline for understanding what parking is. I'm not quite sure what that could be, and I'm going to throw out two alternative possibilities for what it could be. One is that there is no there. It's simply kind of the subpart F rules in 962 were just some sort of a compromise, sort of a realization-based nonsensical thing, two commonly owned entities who had income and so forth. So it's really just a matter of how far towards worldwide you want to go. And worldwide consolidation, you want to go without any kind of coherent way to do it, then we kind of don't know what parking quite is. But an alternative idea would be that we decided that in the 62 rules that, quote, true active business income that's earned abroad, you really have an active business abroad, and it really is the income that active business earned, that's allowed to get deferral, but nothing else. But if we do that, it kind of turns into the same thing as milking, because it turns out that the problem is that we know if they have passive income abroad that we recognize, we're going to tax it. So it's just that they pretend they have active business income that's abroad that's really not, because they played games. And so, but if that's the case, it's kind of the same as milking. It's sort of misstating parking equals misstating transfer prices, where you only allow an active business thing abroad. So then the two would really be the same problem. So that's just my question. How would you respond to that?
So I agree there's a asymmetry in the way the baselines are working. So for transfer pricing, the reference transaction of unrelated party is supposed to, one is supposed to replicate that exactly minus the synergies issue, which I acknowledge. For the branch case, the way I state it in the paper is that it's a extreme endpoint, but the rules are clearly not meant to equate the subsidiary case with the branch case, but rather it is precisely because we don't go that far that we use the provisions essentially as what I think of as an international base allocation issue. This is why, to me, I mean, this is, I think, consistent with much of what I say, is that the very fact that the in the what I think of as parking, we have to make the decision about international base allocation, that it represents what is truly a distinct problem from what I think of as milking. So maybe there's another way to get at it is to dip into what we've actually done under subpart F. And it seems to me that although coming out of 1962, there were just these generalized statements that the CFC rules were sort of there coming in because we had transfer pricing and haven problems. There are clearly issues under CFC which are generated where we don't, where we may want current inclusions even though there are no pricing problems. So it seems quite plausible to me that you could have a fair price migration of intangibles. But you still may not want to allow the earnings to be parked offshore.
Notion still that you wouldn't have done that at arm's length, that someone who is totally separate from you wouldn't have ended up with all that valuable stuff.
Well, that's exactly my example of the excess profits. I think we don't know. I think to the extent you really think there are supernormal returns being earned through intangibles offshore, that may not be a pricing issue. You may have been able to buy it at arm's length in a domestic economy and earn a supernormal return. If you can move that offshore at a fair price, you may generate a good argument that this, that from a parking perspective, we want to bring that back into the base. That is, because it's a supernormal return, there we don't have the same distortionary problems as with normal return, accepting the points, the very valid points you've made about incremental incentives for inversion activity.
I'm sure there's more to discuss, but partly to leave to the audience, I'll move on to the second. So, John, there's a sunny side to what you say, and I agree with you that, that there seem to be these really big kind of flashing red light things that were then fairly successfully shut down. But this is not really a disagreement with your paper, but I wonder if the way you present it, maybe it's really just that the thing can still survive. It's like more benign than the way I like to see the foreign tax credit. And a starting point, you made a point nicely that's similar to a point I like to make when you said to that basically the foreign tax credit is a coupon. You just turn it in, you get 100% of your money back. And that's, you know, very similar to how I like to criticize the foreign tax credit. And one thing when you start thinking about that is how the abuse cases start looking just the same as the cases that we think are okay. To give an example, you know, from your talk. So I pay too much money in the UK. I deliberately pay too much tax in the UK. I don't care because it's creditable. No good. So we have rules to restrict that. But how is that different, really, from I don't move my investment from the UK to Singapore because I don't mind paying the UK tax rate because the US is going to reimburse it anyway. So in a sense, it's hard to tell abuses apart from things that we apparently think are okay. And of course, the underlying problem is that a dollar paid to the foreign tax authority isn't really the same as a dollar paid to us. So even accepting your point that the really red letter things have been shut down, but noting that there's somewhat similar of their effects versus things we allow, I would say a lot of people would say that the foreign tax credit, and again, there's not a disagreement with anything you see in the paper, the foreign tax credit is supposed to be a really preeminent source of tax planning complexity by U.S. companies. So it's something that's generating enormous waste. The only really good argument for giving foreign tax credits is kind of from a national standpoint, is a reciprocity one. We give credits for you, and you give credits for that for us. But of course, everyone else is going to exemption, so that means they're not crediting our taxes anymore. They're causing their taxpayers to be U.S. tax cost conscious. So you have a and it's of course part of the fact that the U.S. foreign tax system as a whole, foreign source income system as a whole, generates extraordinarily little revenue relative to the amount of tax planning complexity and compliance costs and everything else. So. In a way, when you say the thing is like doing better now, it's like someone who had a heart attack and they managed to restart the heart, but he's still lying in bed with 104 fever. And in that sense, I come to a much less benign conclusion, even accepting the main point you make.
My diagnosis is quite different. I think it is much easier than you suggest to separate what are the abuses of the foreign tax credit that were serious enough to warrant a response from Treasury or Congress from the other ones. And even if I had serious doubts about that, I just don't know how we could tell our companies that, unlike companies anyplace else in the world, you're not going to get double tax relief. I fear that, even though I don't think there's a case for it in the first place, because I don't think that apart from the clearly abusive patterns that have been identified, I don't think people use the foreign tax credit primarily as a means to abuse the U.S. tax system. I think they use it just to get a credit. But I would be very worried, and it folds over into the discussion of the points that Mitchell and David Rose are talking about. I would be very worried that we would create simply too strong an incentive for American companies to expatriate. I think that would be as close to the last straw as we could imagine to say, you might be doing plain old business in plain old countries. You're not engaging in arbitrage. You're not engaging in generators. But we're going to take away a credit. We're going to give you only a deduction. I just don't think it's a plausible scenario.
Well, that's in effect. Well, yeah. Actually, we should. I think it would be
unfair to the audience to try to pursue this any further now. So I'll ask a question to David. I wonder if it's true to say, if it's really correct to say that all this stuff is about allocation of the tax base. We kind of are familiar with the idea that the reason for having a corporate income tax is just a backstop for the individual income tax. And what we mean by that is, if we're taxing individuals on their income, we kind of have to tax corporations on their income, or else the individuals will just earn money through corporations. So when you think about it that way, then you start thinking that when Microsoft and Google and Apple and all those other great companies make a lot of money worldwide. In a sense, the reason why we want to have a tax on Apple or all of these other companies is because they're owned by individuals. And very often we have the original founders who still own a lot of the company. We want to tax those people. And if we could flow through corporate income to the owner level and have a tax purely on individuals, including on corporate income, of course they would be being taxed on their worldwide income, even if they kind of subcontracted it out to Bermuda. And the only stuff we would lose is if they actually paid money to someone who lived in France, of course France would end up taxing that money. So I think the kind of goal of having, say, all of Apple's income, if we really think it's fundamentally generated by the activities of people who live in the U.S. and who own most of the shares, it's not really an allocation of tax base issue. So what about France? France says, well, you're selling Apple products in France. We want to tax it too. Well, what's going on there is one or both of two things. One is they think that the U.S. people are earning rents so that they can, as an economic matter, make the U.S. people pay for entering that market. And that may be true or false. They certainly have a right to try it. And the other is they're actually taxing French people. Remember, Apple sells a thing in France, the tax on the transaction, even if the tax is paid by Apple, we might think it's possibly paid by the consumer, really. So of course, French consumers who earn income and then spend their money buying Apple products, it could be indirectly taxing that. So I don't, actually they may both be taxing the same transaction. It's not really double taxation. So I don't think that allocated, well, I guess my bottom line is, if Apple's really profits are really the result of people in the U.S. doing things, and these people are the ones who own Apple, so they're in the sense really the taxpayers when Apple is taxed, I don't think there's an allocation of tax base issue. There's also not really an issue Germans instead of Americans will become the innovators. Because I don't think anyone thinks if we could tax all income at the individual level, even when it's owned through a corporation, and the U.S. happened to have a particular tax, I don't think we would be thinking that the talented people in Apple, leaving aside someone from Facebook, Severin, who expatriated, leaving aside that, I don't think we'd really say the individuals who live in the U.S. are not going to be the innovators anymore because they're taxed at 35% no matter what they do, including if they do this. So I don't think that the issue on the other side is really one of Americans won't innovate anymore. Well, is there a case on the other side? I think there is. I mean, that's why it's being debated. But it's a different type of case. Basically, the case on the other side is that if we are stuck with a corporate tax and we can only tax at the company level, and both Americans and foreigners don't have to use U.S. companies, the issue is that we could have this big system that uses the entity level worldwide corporate tax on US companies as a way of getting US people when they earn a lot of money, even if they earn it through companies and part of it abroad through subs. And it turns out just to be ineffective. We're imposing some efficiency costs on them because we tell them to avoid US companies. So isn't the other side that you'd have this whole big set of instruments, and it just doesn't work because people can just avoid it. But that's a different, by not using U.S. companies, but that's a different question than the way it's often posed.
So there is a lot there. I will address at least a couple of thoughts. First, I think you're right that we can't just think about the corporate tax as being sort of a natural state of affairs. And so, right, one rationale for the corporate tax is that it is a backstop to the individual income tax. And if that's the reason we have a corporate tax, then I think you're correct to say, well, we really ought to look to the individuals. I will just note that other reasons for the existence of the corporate tax have been put forward. So, for example, you might say we should tax corporations as entities as a means of regulating corporations in non-tax ways. But on the your argument that it is not an issue of allocation of the tax base, I wonder if we may have a labeling problem. So I would like to explore further what you mean by this not being a problem, a question of allocation of the tax base. I would say that saying that we should tax the corporation based on where the people are who either do the work or who own the corporation is what I see as one way of allocating the base, but there are other ways. So it doesn't seem obvious that as an economic matter, where the owners of the corporation and where the managers of the corporation sit is sort of the right answer for taxing the corporation in that place. You could say, we want to look at where the company's tangible property is. You might say, as I've discussed a little bit in the paper, we care about where the company sells its goods. But again, just backing up again, I still view those as an allocation of the tax base issue, but maybe this is more a labeling than a substantive point.
Yeah, we can't really pursue it longer here, but I would say ultimately we're going to want to be thinking about people, some sort of people. They could be consumers, but they're going to be people of some kind. That's going to be, for it to be meaningful, what we're thinking about.
I'm sorry.
I ended up taking more time than I, yeah, why don't you?
I have a good question.
For whom?
So I think it's very difficult to answer that in the abstract, so I agree with many of the arguments in the Worsen exemption paper that I think you're referring to, and it is clear that aspects of our current CFC and deferral approach with especially the in cross-crediting for royalty income presents a big problem for intangibles. So if I just looked at, if I viewed as the taxation of royalty income in isolation, I could say, well, the result we generate under our current rules is worse than what? Than some idealized territorial system, but it just depends on what the territorial system we got actually looked like. And until I had an actual territorial system to compare, I wouldn't sign off on it as a general matter.
I have never been in agreement with the proposals that the United States should do away with deferral. I recognize that at the margin, pushing the rules to the limits, you can use our present system in effect to generate a negative U.S. tax. That is possible. You could at least do things that would make that a possible position that might be sustained. It seems to me, though, that is so far off on the margin that repealing deferral and making, again, I come back to we have to live with the rest of the world. If our companies, unlike companies from every place else, are going to have to pay full 35% tax on all of their profits, I fear that not many of them are going to stay here. So I think you need to balance things. I would not move for elimination of deferral, and I might just make this observation. We've talked a lot about definitions, taxonomy, highly analytical things. I had a golf teacher once who just said, hit the damn ball. It's possible to overthink some of these things. The basic problem is that income, either because of transfer pricing rules or source rules or inadequate base company rules, are placing income where we know it doesn't belong. And I don't really care if it takes two rules or seven rules to correct that. But the first rule to do it would not be, in my judgment, repealing deferral.
Other questions? I'll just say something. But John, you're not saying, though, that I don't think you're saying that deferral is a good rule in the sense that companies that keep the money abroad should pay less U.S. tax than the ones that don't keep the money abroad. What you're saying is that to repeal deferral while all else would stay the same would make the tax burden on U.S. multinationals too high, which is kind of separate in that deferral is just one way among a thousand of lowering the rate, whatever those be.
That's true, but no matter what move we make, whatever direction it goes in, whichever regime we work on it, we just have to be very cognizant of what other countries are going to do. And that's the only point.
Okay, last question for Lee.
How do you have this discussion without talking about the check-the-box rules?
Do you want to borrow this?
How do you have this discussion with Mitchell's chart there without discussing the check-the-box rules, which basically have wiped out most of subpart F, because we're mostly talking about transactions among affiliates? And how do you have the discussion of offshoring intangibles without talking about the cases? And we're talking Lilly, then Bausch & Lomb, then Xilinx, then Veritas, which basically say, never ever are you going to be able to price this thing at more than, you know, a dollar and a half. I mean, you basically had complete breakdown in the enforcement of all this stuff.
I'll try the check-the-box thing first. We've had the Tillinghast lectures that some of you may know about or have attended. I think we've had about a dozen of them now. And afterwards, we have a dinner, and whatever the topic is, there's a free-flowing discussion, and I'd say about 60% of the time we end up talking about the check-the-box rules. The subject might have been Jell-O, but we end up talking about the check-the-box rules. That's the first thing if you're thinking about not overthinking the issue, taking modest steps. The first thing we could do that I think would make substantial improvements is to do what Treasury tried to do about 15 years ago and put hybrid entity rules inside of subpart F. That would cause a huge improvement in the system. Wouldn't cure everything. It would be a very good first start. If you look at some of the studies that the Joint Committee conducted on actual corporations three years ago, all of them, or most of them, and maybe all of them, had to do with bleeding money out of what was a substantial tax country into a haven via royalties typically paid by a check-the-box entity. That change alone would have taken a lot of the value of deferral of the U.S. multinationals under study.
I'll just make one quick point. There have been legislative proposals to, in one way or another, repeal check-the-box, and that's, I think those are fine so far as they go, but when you start thinking about what to replace check-the-box with, it becomes a more difficult exercise.
Yeah, I would just say I absolutely don't think you can have the discussion without check-the-box, but that's just one piece of it, so it's no surprise that subpart F is, you know, essentially being eviscerated over the last 10 years, and part of that's check the box, part of it is weakening the rules on manufacturing, part of it's weakening the rules on services, part of it is the stuff under 956. So we have a major weakening of the regime, to be sure. So the hard question for me is how much of that is sort of a sensible balancing, taking account of the stuff Dan has said, the stuff John just said about figuring out how much deferral we need to give in order to keep U.S. companies in the U.S. versus how much are the cases where we give stuff away under subpart F that we actually don't have to give up. And so that's really the class of cases I'm interested in is where we give up stuff that is allowed deferral in those instances where wouldn't create incremental problems with inversions or new incorporations out of the U.S. And then to the extent that happens, we then say, oh, we've given up too much of the base, and let's fix the problem under 482. That's kind of the main thing that seems completely wrongheaded to me, but it seems to be a path that we've been on.
Well, thank you all, and we'll be back in 3:30.